I'm going to minister to you from Hebrews chapter 12 tonight, but I want to kind of just set the stage for you. So get your Bibles out and get ready to turn in your pages of your Bible. You should carry a Bible to church. No one recognizes that your iPhone is a Bible.
That's right.
Your Bible can be a witness. Hallelujah. Amen. Carry around a Bible. Hallelujah. Amen. Dress up a little bit on Sunday so people at least have some kind of clue that maybe you're doing something, you know, a little different than everybody else is doing. Amen. Exodus chapter 16, verse 4, then said the Lord unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or not. I'm going to lay out some things for you. I'm going to do it supernaturally. I'm going to manifest my glory, and I'm going to set regulations, and I'm going to tell you exactly how to move with my holy things and my miracle things, and I'm going to see if you're going to move beyond what I told you. I'm going to see if you get greedy. I'm going to see if you get selfish. I'm going to see if you got wrong motives. I'm going to see if you got wrong interest. I'm going to prove you whether or not you're willing to be my people and go all the way. He had sanctified them. He had baptized them. They had a Passover experience with the blood of the Lamb. They were all baptized in the Red Sea, and they all got to drink from a spiritual rock. You listening to me? He said, I'm going to prove you. I'm going to see how you handle my miracle provision. I'm going to see how you handle my signs and wonders. I'm going to see if you're going to do it exactly the way I tell you to do it. And if you'll handle my sacred things properly, I'm going to cause you to have a whole lot more understanding about all the things I purpose to do for you and the inheritance that I should give you. For I will make you above all the nations of the earth. I promise you, you will be the head and not the tail. I will make you a royal diadem in my crown that all people can see that you are so precious and elect and a treasure to me, or peculiar, a treasure unto myself. Hallelujah. You'll lend to many nations and not borrow. You will be in charge of the entire world. You're going to step into the promise I made to your great-granddaddy Abraham. Hallelujah. And we saw what happened. They were just like Christian people today, covenant people today. God's miracles start, signs and wonders start happening, and they go off to doing their own thing. I'm not going to. I'm going to tremble in his presence and call all of his sacred things wonderful. I'm not going to take anything that God is doing and use it to promote my own agenda. I'm not going to take anything that God is doing and try to bring some kind of glory to my own name. Come on, man. We want to be hid away in his fame. I'm telling you right now, Father's about to come and reveal his power. He's about to make known his power. He's about to make known his glory. He's about to be exalted in his own strength. I said it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I'm just reminded that just before, a few minutes ago, before we got turned away a little bit, I was about to talk to you just quickly, and I want to say this because it's important, that the disciples had received power. They had received dunamis from the Lord Jesus Christ against all unclean spirits. And the dad came and said, I brought him to your disciples, but they did not have ishku. They did not have the strength to cast out the devil. See, they had the dunamis, but said they didn't have the strength basically to move in what God had given them, because they had, and I'm not going to preach the sermon that I've already preached the other night, but I just want to remind you of this because I'm quickened by the Holy Ghost to do it. You can't be communing with men and processing things after the realm of your own logical thinking and expect that you're going to be able to move in the supernatural supply that God has given you. It may be in there, but because you're listening to wrong advice, you're paying attention to wrong things and come under wrong influences, it's going to shut you down from flowing in the miraculous realm that God's already provided for you. So stop doing that in Jesus' name. Go ahead and eat the good word of God and do the good word of God, because in doing it, in speaking the word of God and doing the word of God, you guys, you watch me, you know, you can, because some of you come up when I'm praying for people. And you know what I do is I'll start quoting the scripture. And when I start quoting the scripture, you know what happens, don't you? You can feel the manifest presence of God. So as I start quoting the scripture. I quote the word of God, and out of the word of God comes forth a miracle. Hallelujah. If people are ready to receive the miracle, I mean, some people aren't ready to receive the miracle because they're holding on to lust. They're holding on to ungodly things. They're holding on to bitterness. They're holding on to unforgiveness. God knows their heart. As soon as they get another opportunity, they're going to be back into the same sin that they, you know, want to get out of at that moment. And therefore, we got to have enough discernment to recognize that and help them break off that yoke and off that shackle. I mean, God gave us a heavenly vision. God gave us the power, as I was talking this morning, to turn people from Satan unto God. And I mean, that is something that we do actively. That is something that we do aggressively. I mean, come on, people. God wants you to get aggressive. I mean, the kingdom of God suffers violence. Violent, taken by force. God has something about a forcefulness within our life to where we will not be without what he's demanded. It's true. That's why he says knock, seek, and ask. That means to demand. Don't mean give me all these things, you know, spiritualize, knock, seek, and ask. It means to demand. Just read the story, the example that God, Christ Jesus gave in Luke chapter 11 before he said knock, seek, and ask. He said he wanted somebody banging on the door, won't go away, demanding, get up and get it for me now. Hallelujah. That's what Father wants. He wants that aggressive passion that says, I'm not willing to live without it. I'm not willing to live without the power of God being made manifest. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I can pick up on the sense when people, I'm out there in the world, they just are aggravated by the things of God. They don't want to hear nothing about God. If you walked up to them, I'm going to tell you right now, you'll find some of the most aggressive and violent people in Southern California. You start talking about Jesus. You'll find aggressive, violent people. Like no place on the planet, I guarantee you. Just try it if you haven't. And I love just go walking by them, or just walking, by them and singing as we were singing a song, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. How does that go? Reveal Jesus like I've never seen or known. Just walk by them singing that real loud and kind of go slow like you're in a wedding march, you know. Oh, hallelujah. Ah. I have the right to be who I am in God. I have a right to be a tabernacling place of God's glory. I have a right to stand with the fire and the presence of God in a public place and be caught away with Him. I'm not concerned about what anybody else thinks. I'm not trying to impress anybody. I'm not trying to get no fame out of anybody. I don't need no statistics or honor from men.
That's right. Hallelujah.
About time some people start living in the brightness of His glory, that we rise and shine and begin to be who God has called us to be, because it won't be long and there's going to be a breaking loose, believe me. It won't be long. There's going to be a shaking of the presence of God. It will not be long. And people are going to know. They're going to begin to respond to this witness of His glory. And they're going to come with their sickness. And they're going to come with their disease. And they're going to come with their torment. They're going to come with their oppression. And they're going to cry out to God to be set free. And you got the goods. You got the goods because you've been giving yourself over to this realm of divine power and glory. Imagine how terrible it would be that there's this great outpouring of God's presence, that God is shaking with Holy Ghost conviction the nations around us, the lost around us, and we don't have enough authority to cast the devil out when they come and lay hold on us crying out for Jesus. And we don't know how to flow in enough anointing to get our own headaches healed. We don't have enough anointing to enough ability to flow in the manifest glory of the Holy Ghost to say no to some little devil. Come on, people, it's time we understand Father's here examining us. He's proving us. He's looking for some people who knew how to drink right. God always picks His army based upon how they drink. Hallelujah. Talk to Gideon. God said, no, there's still too many. Send everybody home that's afraid. Everybody's home just married somebody. Everybody home got some other interest. Their heart's not really in it. And a bunch of people left. Two-thirds left. That's about right. God says there's still too many. Let's see how they drink. Hallelujah. Come on, fix my mic. Don't just sit there. La casa taramai. Lea ramahaya. Harasataramadeya. Haramasai. My kids were coming up. My kids were growing. As they were growing, that's how I spot checked them. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost, Ruth Anna. Okay, she's doing fine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because I can hear it, man. If it ain't a flow, it's a well's been clogged up, stopped up, or something. We're going to get that thing freed up right now. Hallelujah. We're going to understand what you've been thinking about. Hallelujah. What you've been dreaming about. Who you've been hanging out with. Show you how to be mighty in God. Not little, mighty. Hallelujah. Humility and brokenness makes us mighty. It's humility with boldness. It's meekness with confidence. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Go with me to Exodus chapter 20, verse 20 real quick. And Moses said unto the people, fear not. Oh, this is powerful. Because the Father's done come up this first Pentecost, and he's come with his glory. And I'm telling you right now, he's shaking the ground. And I mean, it's thundering and lightning, and his voice is being heard. Listen to me. Exodus 20:20, and Moses said unto the people, fear not, for God has come to prove you. Fear not, for God has come to prove you. And that his fear may be before your faces, that you sin not. Uh-oh. He didn't even find that in the Old Testament. I tell you right now, God is against sin. God will have no partnership with it. It is, I'm telling you, I don't care what anybody tells you, the wrath of God abides upon those who sin. Period. Praise God for the blood of Jesus Christ, so that you can get cleansed, and for the Holy Ghost, so that you can understand how to have enough authority not to be marked by Satan again. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm praising God for the Abiding Place Ministry, a place where people believe they can walk in righteousness, and they're more interested in the Holy Ghost and demon spirits, and they're not looking for an excuse and for somebody to tell them it's okay for them to live like the devil and they can still be holy. I'm telling you right now, that is nothing but deception and lies from the pit of hell. And God has brought to us this wonderful, beautiful cleansing in the blood of Jesus Christ. Our garments are spotless. Yea, they are sinless, whiter than snow. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. I've been filled with the Spirit of holiness. I've been given the power of God. Christ Jesus, the overcomer, lives on the inside of me. God the Holy Ghost, the power of heaven, is ruling me. And God the Father sits upon the throne of my heart, which he made his holies of holies. Hallelujah. I'm fit for the battle. I'm well able to step into the inheritance. And there was only, through all of this proving, we know what's going to happen. Only Joshua and Caleb are going to be allowed to go into the inheritance. That's some crazy statistics. Only two men are willing to believe God and be violent with the things of the Spirit. Everybody else is going to miss out on the move of God. They're going to be just, their carcasses are going to fall in the wilderness. And that ain't a good thing. Just in case you was wondering. The people stood afar off. The people stood afar off. When God's there and his glory is being made manifest, they scared to death. As soon as God gets to speaking, people run in fear and shame and go and hide. They go and hide in their religionity. They go and hide in their beliefs and ideology. Get yourself in the Word and quit listening to all these preachers. Listen to me in Jesus' name. Amen. And what did Moses do? He drew near. Everybody else going retreat. And Moses is going, we know what he wants. I want to see your glory. Well, you're going to die if you see my glory. He don't care. I want to see. He's advancing towards heaven's voice, towards the voice of the Father, towards the presence of the Father. He's advancing. Everybody else is retreating. God's proving them right then. He's sorting them out by his presence, by his manifest presence. He's sorting them out by the terror of his glory. Knowing the terror of the Lord, the grace preacher said. Knowing the terror of the Lord, the grace preacher said. We thus persuade men. The grace preacher said that the grace of God has appeared to all men, teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and live godly and righteously in this world. Because his wrath is coming upon all the workers of iniquity. Jesus said, depart from me, you who never quit sinning. Hello. And we're watching as the apostate church rises to power and the glorious church seems to be being eclipsed. Huh? But I'm telling you right now, we ain't half done. Praise God. Hallelujah. Father's about to do some wonderful things to glorify his only begotten Son. And Jesus is about doing the work to glorify the Father. And the Holy Ghost is right in the big middle of you and me to bring it to pass through our lives. Hallelujah. And he's going to prove us. He's going to try us. He's going to see what we're about. He's going to see what we really want. What do we really got to have to make us happy? What's really going to make us stand up inside and be excited? What's going to really give us that adrenaline rush? Huh? Some kind of the praises of men or the glory of the Master. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And Moses drew near unto the thick darkness. Everybody's running. But Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. Hallelujah. And the Lord said unto Moses, thus shall you say unto the children of Israel, you have seen that I have talked with you from heaven. Now go on in this chapter. But it's just glorious and powerful. And it's all about proving them. It's all about sorting them out. It's all about marking them with his voice. Why? So that them being marked with his presence and marked with his voice, they will not sin and be a part of iniquity. And they will not be snared by demon powers of the people that surround them. But they didn't want to be marked. They ran the other way. God says, oh, I wish there was a heart within them. And see, they say, oh, Moses, you go talk to God, but it's just too scary for us lest we die. They wanted to preserve their own life. Moses didn't want to preserve his own life. Though he counted God's loving kindness better than life. He counted God's presence all that he wanted to be consumed with. People, I'm talking to you. I'm talking about your response to the presence of the Lord. I'm talking about your hunger. I'm talking about your thirst. I'm talking about your unwillingness to be left out of that which God has made available. Because a lot of people are willing to live day in, day out in fellowship with torment, in fellowship with depression, in fellowship with confusion, in fellowship with all kinds of things that belong to this world, when all the time they could have had a glorious heavenly fellowship with the Holy Ghost divine, living in goodness and joy unspeakable and living in all the things that belong to heaven. Come on, people. It's about time that you stand up and recognize the battle that you're engaged in. And praise God, we get to fight from the point of victory, the high ground of victory. Amen. But it is a fight. Deuteronomy 8, chapter 8, verse 16. The Lord said, you will remember all the way which the Lord your God led you these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you. Father took you through the things that he took you through so that he could produce within your life some humility so that you will listen up and start doing what he says rather than doing it your way. And praise God, he got a people that were willing to do that. He got a people that were willing to recite his word continually, day and night, so that they may observe to do all that God had said, so that they could prosper and be successful in the way. They learned how to prophesy over their life and speak out the life and power of God's miraculous word over their life, and it worked. They said, they got to the point where they said, well, whether we live or whether we die, we're going to obey God. I don't care what it costs us. I don't care if we're left out to dry and everybody persecutes us. I don't care if they hang us up by our toes. We're going to obey God. And there's nothing changed about the kind of people that the Lord's looking for, because God does not change. He's the same. 1,000 years is the same as a day with him. It's just like nothing's changed. He's exactly the same as he was. 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, 1,000,000, 10,000,000, 10 trillion years ago. He's
no difference. And we could have just easily, this is easily said in the language, a day is as a million years. We could have just said, a day is as myriads, which could be translated a thousand, but it's more. It's more and more and more and more and more and more. People want God to be different. God is the same God that said, take the Midianites who caused my people to stumble, who caused my people to sin, and slay everyone, men, women, boys, girls. Let not a thing live that breathes. He's not changed one bit. And I'm so happy because he's not having sin in his kingdom. He's not having unrighteousness in his kingdom. He's not having rebellion and defiance in his kingdom. He's not having sickness and disease that comes right along with it in his kingdom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it's about time somebody get big enough to take on the spirit of secular humanism that now reigns in most of the church and knock that idol flat. It's about time that somebody stirred with the zeal of Josiah in this generation that says no more falling down to idols. You know, Solomon built a idol to Ashtart, which is the mother of harlots, the queen of heaven, and it existed until the days of Josiah. That's a long time that they allowed idolatry to go on and that kind of lewd, licentious activity to go on. There's parallels there. You know, there's parallels. These things just repeat themselves. We want to act like that somehow, that we're isolated and we're different from those who passed under the glory cloud. They lived under the glory. They were baptized in the fire. They were not only baptized in the Red Sea, they're baptized in the fire. I just read it to you a few minutes ago. Amen. And what did it work in their life? Be careful, people, lest a promise being left you of entering into his rest, any of you should come short of it. That you would be willing to neglect these good things of God. You'd be willing to neglect his so great a salvation. You'd be willing to just take for granted it's just another option, another opportunity in the milieu of all the rest of opportunities. People, I'm telling you right now, God's come to sort you out. He's come to search you. He's come to try you. He's come to prove you. See what you're all about. See if you want heaven more than you want. Than you want self. That you want the things that he has provided for us rather than the things you can provide for yourself. If every turn in the road, I want to be every turn in the road saying yes to God. I want to be every turn in the road having the right response, saying, here I am. And I know how to do that. Just stay in praise and thanksgiving because I know that I'm under his guidance and I'm under his authority and I'm under his cloud and I'm under his divine provision and I'm under his divine direction and nothing can happen to me that God has not allowed. And I'm going to, if it's something that is the enemy's trying to impose upon me, I have the grace and divine power and the ability to stop it. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 I have the strength and the ability to endure whatever. Praise the name of Jesus. I don't know how many people Paul raised from the dead, but I know how many times he was beaten. I don't know how many blind eyes he opened, but I know how many times he was shipwrecked. I know how many times he was stoned. I know how many times of the list of the various different persecutions that he went through. You listening to me? God gave him the grace to endure it. Hallelujah. God gave him an abundance of revelation. And with that abundance of revelation, the Lord allowed an angel of darkness to persecute him continually, stir up persecution against him, where he said that he was made the offscouring. He became the reproach of every man. Just like Jesus. Jesus became the reproach of every man. Most people won't be tried that way. As soon as the little reproaches happen to them, they get all upset and wonder where God is and why they aren't getting their stuff. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Why ain't all fluffy and going all smooth and nice for me? Father's come to prove you. Father has given to us the glory of heaven. He's poured out his presence in his spirit. He's given to us a place in his divine presence, seated together, exalted us as heirs and co-inheritors. But he's come to prove you and examine you because these are sacred and holy things. This is power and authority that he alone possesses. He's come to prove you to see if he can use you the way he wants to.
I want him to be able to use me the way he wants to, and he'd take as long as he wants. He's going to be fine, and me standing here shouting and being all excited about the great things which the Lord has done for me. Hallelujah. 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 I led you 40 years in the wilderness to humble you, to prove you, to know what was in you, what was in your heart, where your real commitments lie, where your real consecration is, what you really believe, whether or not you would keep my commandments or not. And he humbled you, and he suffered you to hunger, and he fed you with manna, which you had no idea or knew anything about. Neither did your fathers know anything about this manna, that he might make you to know that man lives by bread alone, not by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. You know, the beautiful thing about this is Jesus takes this word and defeats all the host of hell. He said that he might make you to know that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord does man live. You want to live spiritually, this is what he's saying. You're going to have to understand there is a fast. All you have for food and all you want for food is my word. You can't have man's words. You can't have your word. You just got to have my word. You got to have something that comes right down out of heaven. And you don't listen to any suggestion of devils. You don't listen to any suggestion of men. You don't listen to any suggestion from any other realm. And that's why Jesus used this verse of scripture when he was dealing with Satan's suggestion. It said, if you the Son of God, turn this stone into bread. He's saying God has shown us how we're going to continue to live in his realm and live in the realms and the glory of his presence. That we will not listen to any other suggestions. We will not listen to any other words, be it ours or anyone else's. He's come to prove you. He's come to prove me. And that test is constantly going on. And the good thing is, when he sees that, no, we'd rather live by our own word, he goes to working with us to teach us to live by his word. When he sees we're willing to go ahead and move with whatever wind of suggestion comes around, he goes to try us, to prove us, and he sets the fire of his presence upon us. And deals with us, continually pleading with us. He says this. He says, your raiment did not wax old, same suit of clothes, 40 years. Listen to me. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Same clothes, 40 years.
Yeah.
Neither did your foot swell. Same shoes, 40 years. Hallelujah. You shall also consider in your heart that as a man chastens his son, so the Lord chastened you. Huh? And it wasn't just about punishment, although there was punishment. Because when they murmured against God, God went ahead and sent them some diseases. When they murmured against God, God went ahead and put fiery serpents among them that bit them. Huh? Oh yeah, he sent forth the plague among them, diseases. He sent forth serpents among them because of their disobedience. But the chastening here isn't just limited to the punishment. The chastening is about his instruction. He was constantly trying to grab a hold of them and lead them and guide them and take hold of them as a father takes hold of his son and of his child. Therefore shall you keep the commandments of the Lord your God to walk in his ways and to fear him. Deuteronomy 13:3. He says this, you shall not hearken unto the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. The one that gives a prophet that gives a word that is not exactly what God said in agreement with his word. Now,
A prophet that gives a word that is not exactly in agreement with what he's spoken through Moses. A prophet that gives a word and it does not come to pass. See, God's already settled the proof of his word. In time before there was the written word, a proof of the word was that it was witnessed to happen exactly like that prophet or that dreamer of dreams declared. You with me?
Yes.
Well, now, if somebody prophesies or dreams a dream and it is contrary to the word of God, they are not to be listened to. It is not to be regarded. Right. It better be exactly what God said. Right. Otherwise, it is going to lead you into a realm of a demonic stronghold. And God allows it that he may prove you. Just as he says it here. He says, if you hearken unto the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams, for the Lord your God proveth you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all your soul, whether or not you're going to hold to his word, whether or not you're going to hold to the things which he said for us to do and the way that he's told us to walk in, or whether you're just looking for an excuse so you go do whatever it is that you thought you wanted to do, or you're willing to just go ahead and walk off into something that has nothing to do with the presence of the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord, because you spent so much time over with fellowshipping with demon spirits, spent so much time fellowshipping with the devil anyways, you don't even have a resistance against him. You hear the devil speak and you think it's God. You get all excited about it. Feel the anointing. The anointing is the manifest presence of Jesus and his power. That's what the anointing is. So manifest presence of Jesus in his power. The anointing will cause you to fear God. It'll cause you to hate sin and love righteousness. I'm not interested in any other kind of anointing. If the anointing doesn't cause me to just hunger and thirst more after the things of God, I don't want nothing to do with it. Because it's a demonic power. Nothing to do with God. This dung lepo, and he's looking for any just a syllable. But I say, take it. Just in the mante. Oh God, just say this. Say, oh God.
Oh God.
I yield myself to you, Holy Ghost.
I yield to myself to you, Holy Ghost.
Take hold of me.
Take hold of me.
Move me.
Move me.
Explode through me.
Explode through me.
With your glory and your power.
With your glory and your power.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, I pray in the name of Jesus, everything that is in this world is blown up to you. Amen. Not blown up, made bigger, blown up, destroyed.
Yeah. Amen.
Huh?
Yeah,
you may be able to access it like all the rest of the demon-possessed people, but you don't want it because you're not demon-possessed.
Amen.
Huh? You may want to access, it may be available to access like all of the people whose father is the devil, but your father's not the devil and you don't want to access it. Because God's going to prove you. He's going to prove what you're going to do with your cell phone.
That's right.
He's going to prove what you're going to do with your iPad. He's going to prove what you're going to do with your computer. He's going to prove what you're going to do with the opportunities and the blessings that he gives you. It's going to prove you. See what you're going to do when you're around, surrounded by a bunch of people who are filled with hell. Are you going to be filled with heaven? Huh? Are you just going to assimilate and just be whatever it is that, you know, the environment. You just take on whatever environment you are in. People, God has made us, given us the ability to create the environment,
Amen.
To create the atmosphere.
Amen.
That's why I'm constantly pulling on you to flow in the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm constantly pulling on you to get over here in this realm of divine power and glory. Get captivated, captured, raptured rather, hallelujah, by the presence of the Lord. Look with me here in Hebrews chapter 12. Praise the name of Jesus. La zote, la robocase, habrocase. Go ahead and get refreshed for a minute. Caroboceta. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Monde risapa. Rombon de separa. Hallelujah. Hey, By the way, pop quiz. Does anybody know how to draw water from the well? Anybody know how to draw water from the well? Anybody know how to do so? I'm not asking your head, I'm asking your heart. Anybody know how to draw water from, oh, anybody want to draw water? Hallelujah. 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 Somebody said, well, I'm just stuck in a situation. I'm just overwhelmed with this thing. I don't know how to break through. Draw some water. Draw some water. Get yourself a drink. Hallelujah. If I was just in a meeting, if I was just in a meeting somewhere, I could get myself a drink. No, just start rejoicing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just dance around a little bit. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 Woo. Hallelujah. 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 Arama mangaya. Hallelujah. 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 Joy and rejoicing, it's the strength in adversity. Hallelujah. Just get so filled up with God's goodness, man. You won't have room for anything else. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mande rusaka robafe. No kosi rababase rikaya. I want the Holy Ghost to take total control over every dimension of me. And I understand that is expressed in the context of what he did on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, and I don't want it any other way. Hallelujah. I'm going to have that continually. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's come to prove me. Find out whether I like being filled up with him or if I'm okay just having a little bit or willing to go long stretches without any overwhelming companionship and fellowship and interaction with divine power and glory. I'm telling you, that is a terrible statement for God's people, that they're willing to go whole stretches of time without being filled with the Spirit, whole stretches of time without being overwhelmed with divine power and glory, whole stretches of time without being caught up in the realms of his goodness. We're willing to live whole stretches of time without the expression of his joy, without the expression of his love. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you one of the wonderful things that I love. Hallelujah. About the ministry of the Holy Ghost, and especially we begin to minister and we preach for the altar time. We minister and we preach for what God is going to begin to do with you in your heart as we begin to seek him at the end of the meeting. And I'm always so overwhelmed at the glory of his love. Oh man, there are so my, there was so much love in this place on Wednesday night. Hallelujah. Ha Ramanda, and I stepped over into it, and on also on Friday night. Ha Ramange, and I expect to step over into it. I stepped over into it this morning, and I'm expecting to step over into it tonight at the end of the meeting, and then I expect to live on it. I'll live in it in that realm tomorrow. I don't want to be without that beautiful, splendorous, glorious expression of his divine power and goodness. I don't want to just have to hope love, guess love, try to think love. I want to be overwhelmed. I want to be taken captive by love, baptized into love, moved by the love, compelled by the love. Hallelujah. I'm gonna run towards it, not away. I'm laying hold of it. I'm gonna demand it for my life. I'm gonna start screaming and hollering. Hallelujah. Start screaming and hollering. Hallelujah. In much of the time, the expressions of his divine power in love is going to be discovered when you hug somebody that you don't like. When you talk to somebody about the things of God that you don't think deserves it. I'm telling you, God's love is just waiting there. It's like, you know, it's like these treasures, that, you know, these prizes that you discover. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. We're on a treasure hunt kind of thing, you know. Hallelujah. The riches of his glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, but I'm telling you right now, I find that every time I come to him, I find that there's always that place. He's always there waiting for me. Hallelujah. He's waiting. He's waiting. I'm wanting more of his expression of his glory, more of the overwhelming presence of his glory in my life. You know what? He's waiting because he's saying, no, I don't want you to stop yet. He's saying, no, I want you to keep praying. I want you to keep on going. So that's kind of how he's leading me on in. That's when I know it's okay. I can go ahead and stop praying now if I want, because I'm saturated with his glory, saturated with his praise. Hallelujah. Until I am, I know the Father just saying, no, I just want you to keep on ministering to me. Keep on, come on, come on. Yeah. Come on, keep talking. I'm liking it. Yeah. You're blessing me right now. Yeah. Keep on giving my sete. Keep on giving thanks. Come on. Keep on flowing in that which is my treasure. Keep on flowing in that which I suffered and bled and died for you to have. Keep on pressing into this realm, because here I want to produce something in you that is impossible for it to be developed unless you're willing to engage this way. Come on now, don't get distracted. I'm telling you, every word that I'm saying is important for you to be receiving. I'm telling you, you're going to have to understand that there is a place that you're going to. There's a goal that's set before you. There is an excelling that takes place in your life when you know where you're going. When you're in expectation of what God's going to do, when you're not faithless, just thinking that things are going to be the same after you're finished praying as they were before you started, I'm going to tell you, you're going to have some riches from heaven downloaded in your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're getting touched tonight and filled up tonight and resourced tonight so that you can live it out everywhere you go. And I'm expecting that some of you, God's going to raise you up and send you out into the places that are totally out of reach, out of touch. But you're so filled with the glory. Hallelujah. You so know how to access the realms of divine provision. Hallelujah. You're good to go for a whole nation. Amen. Amen. Look with me in Hebrews chapter 12 real quick. Is anybody tired? We'll get you refreshed. I'll get you refreshed. Somebody said it's my bedtime. Well, why don't you start getting over into heaven time? Why don't you stop living to sleep? Or whatever it is. Tell your body, straighten up. Amen. Tell your body is the Lord's anyways. Yes. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Katabasete. Katabasete Rita. Katabasete Rita. Katabasete Rita. The Lord's going to teach you some new tongues here tonight. Katabasete Rita. Leto nombo sito kina. It's going right into your spirit. Ha te kane tapo. Bandole peasi. Halamonzesi. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Nangote remanjese koda masi. Monde caro mondo kudishi vade. Monconde ripata solo mongande. Mongota si rabata kalamose. Banglo se precanda bonda kaya ramande rimande la monjasaya. Humbo salamea. Hallelujah. No, I'm just telling you what, I'm so hungry for a great outpouring of Pentecost. I'm cooperating with Pentecost. I'm so hungry for a greater demonstration of the power of God. I'm going to just cooperate with the power of God. I'm not going to sit offline, do whatever it is going on in the atmosphere or what my chemistry of my body's promoting. People, God ain't called you to live by molecules. God ain't called you to live by hormones. God's called you to live by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. He's called you to walk in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Ah, Mosataya. Bavrabaranaya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sutaha. Sutahaya. Ah, Mandeya Faya. Mandeya fara basusti. Mandara bakasha tofresi. Mambra basikisti teo. There are some of you in here tonight, you've never understood how to stand up against temptation. It comes and it just grabs you by the nape of the neck and rubs your nose right in its pollution. And then you go to lapping it up. Huh? Dog don't even do that. You with me? Yeah. Dog don't even do that. Dog shamed by that.
Yeah.
Demons do cause men to do things that animals will not do. You need to go on a fast.
Yeah.
You need to fast and pray.
Yeah.
You need to get serious.
Yeah.
Somebody said, well, you know, they so and so they need their food. No, you don't. Well, they might get sick. No, they won't. Amen. They might not grow right. I promise you, you will grow right. If you've got things going on in your life that's not right with God, you better shut it down now. If you don't shut it down now, it's going to be a bigger stronghold in your life next week, next year. And it'll be more of assurance that you'll never break free and you'll spend eternity in a place called the lake of fire. Because that's what God says. Let no man deceive you. God has made it very clear. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the children of disobedience. You got to find out whether you're a child of obedience or whether you're a child of disobedience. God's come to prove you. God's come to prove you. He allows temptation in part just to prove you. He's given you more authority in your life than Satan has combined with all of his host of hell. You have more authority in your life than Satan has with all of his host of hell combined. You without excuse. You got it. There's not even logical to say that you're going, there's some reason that you should be taken by sin and overcome by it. It's not even biblically logical. There's no rational thinking to somebody who's been baptized in the Holy Ghost, whom the Holy Ghost has filled them. They immersed in his presence. They've got a new heart and a new spirit. They have the divine nature. They're a new creation. Old things have passed away. It's not even logical that somehow that what Adam did through his disobedience should be greater in effect than what Christ Jesus did for you through his obedience.
Amen.
That what Adam did through his death somehow is greater in effect than what Christ Jesus did through his resurrection from the dead. It's not even logical. It's a deception.
Amen.
Satan's a master of his craft.
That's right.
He's a master of his craft. It's not even logical. You don't even have the privilege to even get to the place of whether or not God's grace is sufficient to forgive you as a person that continues on in sin. You can't even get to that point because the logic of it has already been bankrupt. You can't even get to that place to talk about whether or not the Lord is going to somehow overlook sin. He doesn't overlook sin. In the time of your ignorance, God overlooked it. But now, he commands all men everywhere to repent. Because Christ Jesus will come and judge the world in righteousness. Now you look in here with me in Hebrews chapter 12. Verse 1. Are you still flowing in the Holy Ghost just silently? Yes. You're just sitting there going, it's happening, right? You're just kind of holding it back, right? I'm just checking. Hallelujah. Just checking on you. Just checking. Doing an oil check. Doing an oil check. The scripture having laid out for us this great company of those who walked in faith, who went beyond the measure of what we could even think that a person without the Holy Ghost could even do. What we could even think that a person who was not born again could even do. And yet there in Hebrews chapter 11, we are shown the greatness of Abel. We are shown the greatness of Enoch. We've shown the greatness of Noah. We've shown the greatness of Abraham. We've shown the greatness of Moses. We've shown the greatness of Elijah and the prophets and those who were tormented and afflicted. We've shown the greatness of those who escaped the edge of the sword, who out of weakness was made strong, who waxed valiant in fight, who put to flight the armies of the alien, who quenched the violence of fire. And they have no... And we are living in a different, altogether a different category, almost where there's no comparison to what we have now received in divine grace. It seems like the people of the past had so far less but did so much more with it. And in light of this, Paul said in Hebrews chapter verse 1, he says, therefore, seeing as you are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, and he's talking about a company of mighty men that has already proved that we can walk with God through everything that hell and everything that the powers of darkness and everything that life and situations can throw at us. Hallelujah. There's already been proof. Jesus already came and he condemned sin in the flesh, proving that it don't belong in the flesh. It don't belong in the flesh. He condemned sin in the flesh. He proved it don't belong here. We in the image and the likeness of God and have been restored in his righteousness and real holy.
Oh yeah. Satan was able to make man so unlike God, so foreign, so absent of God's glory in 1,565 years that God said, it repents me that I ever even thought of making such a creature. God has put a restraint upon the powers of darkness over these past 4,200 years. But I'm telling you right now, the rise of the apostasy is well underway. And men are being swept into a deception of the demonic. And it is witnessed by this, that they say they know God, and they turned his grace into licentiousness, a right to commit immorality. And it has been a high mark and witness since everything that anybody has ever prophesied, and especially in the New Testament, of the rise of the apostasy. And people, I'm telling you right now, God's come to prove you. Amen. See whether or not that which he's done for you through his only begotten Son, that which he's done for you through the mighty power of his resurrection, that which he's poured out upon you by the fire of his presence, the outworking of his glorious mercy and grace, where he baptized us in his very own person, filled us with his very own life, of how valuable it is to us. He's come to prove you.
Amen.
Come to prove you.
Amen.
Come to prove us. Yeah. See, as we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. The Lord tells us, let us lay aside every weight and every sin which would beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. This isn't some kind of process. This is a consecration, a commitment to cleanse yourself from every filthiness of the flesh and the spirit, perfect in holiness and the fear of God. In other words, you come out from among it. You don't allow yourself to get in that environment. You live in a place called sterile. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Instead of a place called contaminated. Hallelujah. Because he called you righteous, not unrighteous. He called you light, not darkness. He called you Christ, not Belial. He said, I come to live in you and walk in you and dwell in you. I'm your God, you my people. Come out from among them, touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. So therefore, cleanse yourself from all the filthiness of the uncleanness. Don't allow it around you. That is so seated. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 is so seated in so much Old Testament scripture. That there's no reason that anybody in the church should in any way misunderstand that verse, and especially in the context from which it appears. Lay it aside. Get it done. Don't relay the foundation of repentance from dead works and faith towards God. Let's go on to perfection. Let's say right now we kings and priests, we belong to the Most High God. We're filled with the glory of heaven. And all the things that in this world is blown up, it's dead to us. We're dead to it. Even though there's an option to go and to access it, we want nothing to do with it.
Yes.
It will not be long. And those things will not exist anymore. It will not be long. And every satellite will fall out of the sky. It will not be long. It will not be long. And all these things that have snared God's people and they've allowed themselves to be polluted with, they won't even be around anymore. May there be a different kind of trouble. Dear people, I pray today that you come to understand there's not an opportunity for all eternity for you to live as big in God as you can right now. There's not a time in all of eternity for you to express your love and thankfulness for all that he's done for you as it is right now. Amen. When you stand against the current and the tide of every demonic thing and the popular opinion, and you are willing to take hold of God and choose him alone, virtuously, totally separated unto him, saying, I want nothing to do with everything that is your enemy and all that is against you and all that hates you. There's never a time that we get to live so big for God. There's never a time, Easton, that you get to be trained up. Your little spirit is to be trained up in God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Easton told me the other day his favorite scripture, passage of scripture that he likes to quote, Ephesians chapter 3, 14 through 21. I said, that's very good. And he went to tackling it. Praise God. You keep tackling it. Because that's there's no greater treasure in earth than that. Hallelujah. Those are the words from the Lord God of heaven, creator of everything, redeemer of our souls and of our life. And it's work, that'll work mightily in you. Hallelujah. It works mightily in those that believe. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you weary and be faint in your minds. You have never resisted unto blood, standing against battling sin. But God expects you to say no to it. For blessed is the man who endures temptation. For after that he is tried, he shall receive a crown of life and a crown of righteousness that will not fade away. But believe me, if you overcome of sin and overcome of the devil, there's no crown for that. But there's only a fearful looking unto the fiery judgment and indignation. It's true. Look at what Jesus went through to secure you, because that's already been settled here. Jesus went through all that he went through to secure us. He went through that all he went through to guarantee our overcoming victory, to guarantee that Satan could only go so far and that we had absolute power and authority over him. Hold this. My goodness, what a struggle. Hey, come here, girl. Now you're going to have to stop this fussing and fighting. In Jesus' name, give me this. What's this? I might need a lighter Bible. Here, take that one. Give me this one. We got to get all organized over here. Hallelujah. 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 God expects you to say no to sin. Are you listening to me?
Amen.
I'll tell you again, are you listening to me?
You got sin going on in your life, you don't have a right to pick up trash in the church. You hear me? You don't have the right to pick up trash. Huh? You contaminate His glory. Get rid of it by the blood of Jesus Christ. Stay free of it by the power of the Holy Ghost. Because we're talking about a great cloud of witnesses that had far less. And look at how they walk with God. Hallelujah. Pulled us up. I don't want to be ashamed around Enoch. Hey, listen to me. There's a great cloud of witnesses looking. Enoch's looking right now. Huh? Elijah's looking right now. Saying, Father, let us in. Let us in. Put us in. You know, like, put us into the game. Put us in. Put us in. These guys are blowing it. Put us in now. Put us in. Look at what Enoch stood against. He stood against sin and iniquity and apostasy that none of us could even imagine. It's going to happen. It's not yet. The time is not yet. The time is not yet. You believe me. What you need to be concerned about is that your time could come at any moment. I guarantee you, before the time of the Lord Jesus comes, the church aren't going to be saying we're going to go through the tribulation. They're going to be begging God to deliver them now. You believe me? Oh yeah. Because I know that the empire of the ten kings shall rise before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, before the catching away, rather not the coming, but the catching away of the church and the revelation of the Antichrist. And during the time of the rise of the ten kings, people will think that they are in the tribulation, and the church will be crying out to be delivered. You believe me. Hey, to sit around over here in their apostasy land, feeding their selves with all these things that belong to the world, saying that somehow they're going to walk through the tribulation and be some great conquest of, in the hand of God. Give me a break. What a bunch of foolish people. What a bunch of foolish children that have erred from the truth. Haven't got enough power to overcome sin right now, and somehow they're going to be the witnesses of God when Satan has power over the saints. Give me a break. Once again, not even logical, has no relevance to the reality of what's going on in the tribulation. Listen to a bunch of apostasy preaching. You listen to me, because I know what I'm talking about. I'm declaring it from the Word of God. Hallelujah. I'm declaring it by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. And the Word of God will stand and perfectly back me up. Praise God. Hallelujah. And you gotta read my new book. Somebody say, we don't need to read books. This is all Bible book. Amen. It's called the Final Kingdoms on Earth. The Final Kingdoms on Earth. And it's going to scare you. It's going to also fill you with the word of truth and the knowledge of the Lord to know exactly how the prophetic events will unfold from here to the time of the second coming of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm so blessed that I will not be around. I will be caught up, praise God. You know, I'm just believing the Lord's going to do some extraordinary signs and wonders, hallelujah, in life. And I'm not going to limit how long I'm going to live. I'm praying on being around at least about 120 years. Hallelujah. And we plan, we sowing into it, man. The way we pray, the way we move in God, the way we eat, the way we exercise, everything. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to be in heaven, but I tell you right now, I see that there is a great need for people like me on this earth. Praise God. If, you know, the Lord can raise up a whole bunch of people to take my place, but you know what? I want to be right in the big middle of all that's going on here. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to leave the rest up for you to read. When the book comes out, Charisma is going to publish it here pretty soon. Look here with me in verse 5. Now, he says, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaks unto you as unto children. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord. See, we just heard that. What father took all them through and all the challenges they went through, and they didn't get to go shopping. They had to have one suit of clothes, and they didn't get to get new shoes. They had to have one set of shoes, and they didn't get a manna for breakfast, a manna for lunch, and manna for supper, manna stew, manna casserole, manna meat, manna bread, huh? Manna smoothie, manna juice, manna. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And every time they did wrong, Father corrected him and chastened him to try to bring him to a place of obedience to do that which was right. But they hardened themselves against God, so their carcasses fell in the wilderness. They never stepped into the inheritance of God because they were unwilling to walk in perfect obedience to God. And Hebrews chapter 3 and 4 says that's an example for us, lest we fall after the same manner of unbelief. And the Lord says to us here, he says this, he says, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he's chastening, and he scourges. He scourges. That's the word that was used for Jesus at the whipping post. Flogs. Look at that again. Everybody stare at it. There's everybody stare at it. Because I know you didn't read that verse of scripture before. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and flogs every son whom he receives. Hallelujah. Been flogged lately? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What's all that about? Huh? He's saying no sin in your life. No disobedience in your life. No rebellion in your life. No stubbornness in your life. Hallelujah. He demands perfect obedience. God demands perfect obedience. God demands that we be conformed to the image of the Son. God demands that we come out from among them and do not be conformed to the world, but be transfigured by the renewing of our mind or by thinking different. Hallelujah. About who we are. This is what the Lord says. Are you a son? Somebody tries to say that this isn't supposed to be in the Bible. No, it's not supposed to be in your doctrine. It is supposed to be in the Bible. No, it's not supposed to be in your belief system. It don't fit into any, it blows up everything that you, all your neat little ideas about God has just now been busted. Hallelujah. I pray in Jesus' name that every neat idea that I have about God that's not right, that God comes and blows them up in my life right now. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to take me through a walk, a daily walk in relationship with him, that he may teach me to walk in his ways, to prove me, to examine me. He's going to do the same thing to you, and I pray in Jesus' name you'll obey him and quit falling out of the enemy and quit committing acts of treason against God and crimes against the kingdom. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
He says, now that we got finished with the flogging, if you endure chastening, listen to me, if you endure it, some people start getting rebuked and chastened, I'm out of here. There's no love around here.
Yeah, that's right.
As soon as the correction comes out, ain't nobody love me. Father never even called anybody to love you anyways. He's called you to love everybody. Amen. He's called you to love, not be loved. And people don't endure his correction. They don't endure his correction in the church. They're stubborn and rebellious, just like Israel. And their carcass is going to fall just like theirs. In the wilderness, not in the inheritance, they're never going to know what it means to live a victorious, more than conqueror life. And they're going to die and go to a place called the lake of fire. Because they refused to hear the word of God, refused to take hold of his salvation. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes. If you endure chastening, and in other words, you accept it and you receive it, yes. God deals with you as sons. Praise God. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? I really wasn't pleased by having to give Joshua such a hard spanking and Daniel such a hard spanking. And Elizabeth such a hard spanking, and Ruthie Anna such a hard spanking. One time I didn't have anything but a vacuum cord, and we applied it appropriately with extreme pain. Hallelujah. Because I didn't want to ever have to do it again, I wanted to get it all done with that one time. Amen. It was done. Amen. Why? Disobedience. Disobedience. It's not going to work. Hallelujah. And if you lie to me, you're really in trouble. God hates it. There's things that God hates. God, there's things that are abomination to the Lord. Somebody said, oh, he just hated it in the Old Testament.
God doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He hates it. He's not grown and matured and feels different about things now. You know? Jonathan Edwards said, sinners in the hands of an angry God. Now they want to have sinners in the hands of a loving God. Yeah, you're not going to get a great awakening with that one, I promise you. I promise you. Although it's true, it's misapplied by context. You can't hijack something that is absolutely certain about calling people to repentance, because God's never going to, people don't realize this. I was sitting with a guy ministering to him on the airplane, and he was a financial guy with the clinical stuff here in San Diego and around the world. He's from New Jersey. I spent about 2 hours talking to him about the things of the Lord, and you know, and then it came to a point he wanted to, he said, well, what is secular humanism? And you know, and I just let it go for just a moment. And he said, well, you know, I just try to be good and do what's right. I turned to him and I said, it's not acceptable. You're not acceptable to God. There's nothing about you that God likes or will ever accept. You are unfit. And he gave me that look. I said, that is secular humanism. You want to be acceptable. You're fine. You should be received just like you are. God accepts no man's person. He said, oh, God's going to accept me like I am. No, he's not. He will call you like you are to change you. And when he changes you, then you'll become holy and acceptable unto God. And until then, and there's only one means by which that can happen. You listen to me. You might fool your parents. You can't fool me. Because I got a gift of discerning of spirits. I see exactly what's going on in your life. And I'm just going to tell you, I'm just going to let you know. I'm going to start telling your parents what I know. Some of you, I'm just going to tell you. Because you're not sneaking around playing the hypocrite no more. I mean, I'm just going to put the trumpet to my mouth. I mean, I've already, you know, we cycle people through here all the time. We'll just cycle you too. You know, it's God's house, his rules.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Somebody said that Ruth Anna needed to give the phone back. She's not going to give it back. And if you buy your kids another one, we're going to take that one from you too. How you like that? Yeah. Just buy them another one. Put a bunch of money into it, because we're going to come and hijack it from you. And if you don't like that, you don't need to be around here. Amen. You just go to hell. Go to hell on your own. Don't drag us with you. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Is that clear enough?
Yes.
Okay, just checking.
Yep.
Not interested in seeing young people around here want to sneak around, play around on God, and then contaminate other people and mislead them into wickedness and unrighteousness. No, go play your game somewhere else.
Yeah.
I'm gonna take care of the sheep. I'm going to watch the innocent and protect them.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I just heard the Lord shout, God's house, God's rules.
Amen.
No, I'm not kidding. I just heard the Lord shout. I just heard out of heaven the Lord shout. I just heard out of heaven the Lord shout, amen. I just heard the amen say amen. I'm not kidding you. I just heard out of heaven the amen say amen. I'm not kidding you. Some of you look like I just got stuff. I just heard shout out of heaven. I heard the amen say amen. I'm going to tell you right now, God is zealous for his house. I know exactly what he wants. I know exactly how he feels about sin. I can see what happened when Jesus was crucified and hideously tortured at Calvary. I know exactly how he feels about sin. He lit an eternal torture chamber on fire and said, it's going to burn there, and I'm going to be pleased by it. Hallelujah. I just heard amen shout out of heaven, amen. Do you really actually believe that there is a place where you can actually interact, hear and see things in a realm of the unseen? I tell you, there is, but you're not going to even begin to be a part of it until you're willing to be consecrated and set apart under the things that belong to the spirit of holiness. Oh, heaven's real. Heaven's so real. You'll start getting an adrenaline rush about everything that God is doing. You just think about it and you just overwhelm. Just think about the goodness of God and you lose the English language. Just begin to think about all that God has done, and all you can do is just babble, ba 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 ba. It's true. Hallelujah. Woo! My goodness, I'm so glad I'm caught up in heaven. I'm so glad I got holy emotions. I'm so glad I got the power of the living God. I'm so glad that I have clean escaped hell and damnation and sin and wickedness. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. You parents, you better not harass Ruth Anna. She's a Holy Ghost preacher. I mean, right after the heart of God, you got a problem with her, you come talk to me. She's carrying out divine orders, and I'm her bodyguard. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Woo! I'm just so excited about Holy Ghost preachers in my house. That's why Mom and I prayed for it. Said, Lord, all we want is our children to be filled with the Holy Ghost, to be filled with purity and holiness and the things of the Spirit, to prophesy, to be given completely over to you. All church was about to me was seeing my children establishing the things of heaven, and everybody else, if they wanted to listen in and do what we said, you could be a benefactor of it. People along the way choosing, making their own opinion, saying I agree or I disagree or whatever, and they got whatever they got the results that they planned for. They got the consequences of their decision or the rewards of their decision. Because there's no inconsequential decisions that you will make. You better be making sure that you're making the right decisions, because God come to prove you. Amen. Hallelujah. You better start understanding that there's more going on around here than what meets your eye. You got to be understanding there's more going on in this realm, in this place, than just a human being speaking out what he knows out of his own understanding and knowledge. But God, the Holy Ghost, is bigger than all of us, and he's going to make known those things that belong to his heart and to his will in the midst of this church. Because there's a bunch of people in this place that want to know, so God's going to speak. Yeah. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I hope I'm not keeping any of you too long. You know, I feel sorry for you if I am, because I'm going to keep on going. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Whoa. Hallelujah. Woo. But, if you are without chastisement, you ain't been flogged, whereof all are partakers, then you a bastard and not a son.
That's right.
And I'm not going to be one of them.
That's right.
I'm going to get chastened. I'm going to get corrected. I'm going to be jerked around and flogged, whatever it takes. Amen. You know, the scripture says, Peter says, he said, we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, having received the end of our salvation. Though if needed, we are in manifold different types of trials, that the trying of our faith, that we're in the midst of suffering. We're in the midst of a whole bunch of sorrow. We're in the midst of an overwhelming situation, that the trying of our faith, which is much more precious than gold, though be tried by fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at his coming. If some people are on the need, it's on a need, it's on an individual as needed basis. Let me just hold your finger on Hebrews. Let me show you, because some of you are looking at me like that ain't true. Some of you look like, he's trying to trick us. He's trying to misquote a scripture, see if we'll recognize it. 1 Peter chapter 1. Are you, turn over with me. 1 Peter chapter 1. Okay, are you with me?
Yes.
It says, verse 9, receiving the end of your faith, which even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation the prophets have inquired. Forgive me. I want to back up. Verse 6. I messed it up. Okay, verse 6. Wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if needed, you are in heaviness. In other words, you are overwhelmed with some floggings. You are overwhelmed with some chastening and correction. You not where you want to be. You on the backside of the wilderness with no food or water. And crying out, oh God, where is your divine provision which you promised? You're just going to have to get around somebody who knows the Lord so he can speak to the spiritual rock. Hallelujah. You're going to have to get around the people of God where the manna is falling. Manna only fell in God's camp. Hallelujah. See this? That the trying of your faith, which is much more precious than gold, that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now go back to Hebrews chapter 12 with me. Come on, people.
Come on, does this fit into your blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places? Does this fit all over there into that realm of the rivers of God flowing out of you? Christ Jesus tabernacling in you? This is about learning obedience, perfect obedience. That's the context. Amen. This is about not having weights and sin in your life. This is about not having Amen. Those same things that the error that Israel yes. fell after when God came in their midst to try them and prove them, yes. to show them that man cannot live by anything but by the word of God. And if they live by other words, they're going to die. Yeah. Yeah. Live by the words, you're going to die. Yeah. So, the Lord says, furthermore, we have had fathers, he's trying to reason with us, we've had fathers after the flesh, you know, who flogged their kids. Huh? I just told you about a flogging that Elizabeth and Ruth Anna got. There was nothing else available but a vacuum cleaner cord, and we used that. And we were at church, but we were in my office at the church. Huh? They just disobeyed. They disobeyed, and they knew they disobeyed. But, Dad, we just wanted to. Well, you're not going to want to after this. I guarantee you. I liked Hannah the other day. She breaks out the Proverbs, and she goes reading the Proverbs before she administers the belt. That's good. We'll read the Word of God first, and then we're going to minister the belt. Very good approach. Furthermore, we have had fathers after the flesh which have corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much more, brother, be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For truly, listen to this, for they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure. They chastened us. I chastened my kids because I didn't want them to embarrass me. I chastened my kids because I wanted them to behave and act right. Huh? Not be a reproach to the family. But the Lord says that he does it for our own profit. Why? That we might be made partakers of his holiness. Are you listening to me? God demands that we perfect holiness. Without holiness, when holiness is defined by his holiness, because he said, be holy just like I'm holy. You righteous just like I'm righteous. Walk just like I walk. Do just what I do. You be pure just even as I am pure. Hallelujah. Did you get all of that? Be perfect even as I am perfect. Walk before me and be perfect, says the Lord to Abraham. Hallelujah. Now, no chastening for the present seems to be joyous, a Holy Ghost meeting, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yields something. It yields what? Perfect obedience, the peaceable fruits of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. So therefore, those of you going through some hard situations, those of you going through a flogging right now, those of you going through some correction and some chastening, those of you seem like you being held back and not able to move forward, what does the Lord say? He says, quit acting all downcast. Quit acting all abused. And lift up those hands which hang down and strengthen your feeble knees. Don't walk around all weak-kneed. Make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way. Rather let it be healed. Follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any man allow a root of bitterness to spring up and trouble you, and thereby many be defiled, lest there be any fornicators around you, or profane persons like Esau, who for a morsel of meat sold his birthright. For you know how that afterwards when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully or intensely with tears. For ye are not come unto the mount that might be touched. And you not come to that place that burned with fire and with blackness and darkness and tempest, which, by the way, Moses ran to while everybody else ran from. But you come to a more dreadful place. You've not come to the place where there's just the sound of trumpet, the voice of words, a voice which they heard, which waxed louder and louder, if you go back and read the account in Exodus, which entreated that the word should be not, which they then entreated and said, don't speak to us lest we die. Talk to Moses and let Moses come and talk to us. What a terrible insult against the Father that men do not want to hear his voice, his audible voice. What a terrible insult against the Father that we don't want to hear his word and recognize that he's given us power and divine ability to do what he said, empowered us to live in the glory of it, that we should despise this wonderful salvation and this wonderful grace that has been given us. Let nobody in here be of such vile and contemptible nature. Be more noble and honorable in God, to treasure that which God has commanded, to delight in his ways and to cleave unto him and want only him, in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Because I'm telling you, there's not a person in here hunger and thirsting after righteousness that's going to be anything less than filled up.
Amen.
Amen. Papa's going to do everything he's promised. I promise you. Hallelujah. For they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it was such a holy place that it had to be stoned or thrust through with the darts. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. He said, but you are come to Zion. Hallelujah. That's where we at right now, even though Naomi is squawking and messing up the recording. Come here. We can all hear you preaching, travailing. We love you, baby. We love you, baby. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for baby. Thank you, Father, for filling her with the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father, for giving her a good and a right spirit. Hallelujah. That even when she's tired and worn out, she'll rejoice.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Even when things aren't going her way, she'll be thankful and happy. Hallelujah. Kona Manjesi. For you come into Mount Zion. You hear, this is far more dreadful. It's far more intense. It's far more sacred. It's far more holy. And it's where we at right now. You come unto Zion. You come on to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly, church of the firstborn, which is written in heaven, to the God, the judge of all, the spirit of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. See that you do not refuse him that speaks. For if they did not escape who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall you not escape if you turn away from him that speaks from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not only the earth, but also the heaven. Stand with me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't go anywhere yet. Just hold on. Just 1 minute. I know people got to run to the restroom. Just 1 minute. Just 1 minute. Just 1 minute. Expand. I just pray right now for the ability to, for 1 moment. You just got to hear this. You just got to hear this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven just a minute. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, Father's called you to come dwell in His love. Father's called you to come dwell in His presence. Father has invited you to come live in the realms of the holies of holies. If you're willing, you're not going to have to deal with all this disobedient stuff. You're not going to have to deal with all these things where you're not willing to be. You're not willing to move forward. A child, you could be a child that is corrected and obey God and not have to continually go through it. Are you listening to me? I quit spanking Joshua after he was 12 years old. Praise God. Hallelujah. He hadn't been spanked this instant. Praise the Lord. I mean, praise the name of the Lord. He was willing to be obedient. Would you be obedient? Will you just respond to what God is saying? So you don't have to live your whole life getting whipped. You don't have to live your whole life getting chased and going from one problem to the next problem, one set of issues to the next set of issues, because you're not willing to obey the spiritual laws of life that are in Christ Jesus. Oh, people, come now, children, hearken unto me,
and I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is he that desires life and would love to see many good days? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips that they speak no guile. Depart from evil. Pursue peace.
Hallelujah. Ako ramanda stakia today ashita. Labonga de sepeliana moshta. Hallelujah. Brava sokora dea. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Reba sikita. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kando roshande ifrena masheko. Melinda bernanas. It's okay, Josh. Hallelujah. 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 People, I want you to understand very, perfectly something. Turn up, son. The Lord hasn't purposed that you and I live constantly as little children, having to be corrected and chastened. Father has purposed that you and I step into sonship as young men who are walking in obedience, who the Word of God abides in them, and they've overcome the wicked one. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It really, the bottom line of it is, Father has really, and we should grab a hold of it and take it as it really truly is meant to be received, that we've stepped into our inheritance, that we're not walking around in a wilderness, that we've stepped into the plan of God and we're walking as heirs of God and co-inheritors with Jesus. Paul just uses this example to really drive home the point that we cannot fall after the same manner of unbelief as those who the gospel is first preached to and not end up in the same consequence, not end in the same problem. We can't walk around in sin. We can't walk around in the weight of our own will and opinions and be that which God has purposed us to be in Him. Because once again, He tells us by contrast there, He says, you're not in the wilderness. You're not there at Mount Horeb or Mount Sinai. Now you're over in the kingdom of God. Now you're standing before the presence of the Lord, innumerable of angels. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you can't stand around sinning in the kingdom of God, being disobedient in the kingdom of God, walking in unrighteousness in the kingdom of God, and expect you're not going to be corrected.
Amen.
You hear me? And I believe with all my heart that there's another, of course, there is another dimension of this where that the Holy Ghost has come to teach us the ways of life and instruct us in the ways of life that we never are going to outgrow. And I want to learn them all. I want to be a proper child, you need to, of a tender heart. Then when the Lord says, no, you're not walking in meekness, that I'm not going to be hard-headed. Amen. And just go ahead and bullhead my way right on through and just behave in the same way that I was behaving.
Amen.
But I'm going to be tender before Him and say, Father, forgive me. We And he corrects me and says, no, you're not speaking right. You're speaking of your own self. You're not speaking by the Spirit. You're not speaking by my words. You're speaking your own words and acquitted. That I'll be sensitive and tender towards them and stop speaking wrong words. They're speaking his words. Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful that we have a teacher here to teach us? I'm telling you right now, there's people, and maybe you're watching by web, probably not in here. You sit and you watch movies full of licentiousness. That is the worship, by definition, of Baal Peor. You sit and watch it because Satan strategically designed the way that films are made in Hollywood. And you participate with that iniquity. Sure, your heart's going to be hardened against God and you're not going to be sensitive to him. And sure, he's going to correct you for that and chasten you for that. But you should respond to his chastening and to his correction. You know, the Lord spoke to me and he said, many steal from my people godly sorrow. They want to bring, they're under the influence of the humanistic spirit and want to make everybody feel good about themselves. And they steal godly sorrow. You did wrong, you need to feel terrible. You need to feel like on the scale that you just trampled the blood of Jesus underfoot and brought him into an open shame by your behavior. Because then there will be within you a resolve. That's repentance. Father, I'm sorry. I'm broken sorry. Crucify Jesus afresh. I don't want to do it. The sacrificial system, you had to come and lay your hands on an offering, a goat, a bullock, while the priest slit the jugular veins. And I'm telling you right now, it's a pretty gruesome sight. Blood goes everywhere. With the pump of the heart. And the Lord's just trying to show us. And here's an innocent victim taking our place of our punishment. That's truly vicarious. What Jesus did at Calvary's cross was not substitutionary nor vicarious. For the miracle of death is something that we participated with him in. But we need to. There needs to be godly sorrow. What does godly sorrow work? Repentance. If there's not godly sorrow about your wrongdoing and your sin, then that's not repentance. Father, work within us such a right spirit in every way. Hallelujah. Such an obedient spirit in every way. Hallelujah. Kandoshi prisagadola mashikita la mosapata ramamadeshi. Madam Rebekita la mosapahatishi. Harababakatast. Harababasati frivehishti. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your precious blood.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your precious blood.
We were not redeemed.
With corruptible things.
Such as silver and gold.
But by the precious blood.
Of the Lamb.
By the precious blood.
Of Jesus.
As a Lamb.
Without spot.
Or blemish.
Oh. 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 Oh, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.